I'll describe the first major goal and the first five recommendations. Our first goal is to promote structural and cultural changes in science that will move us beyond interdisciplinary research, which brings investigators from different disciplines together to cooperatively work on a problem, towards transdisciplinary efforts, which integrate tools and expertise from multiple disciplines to accelerate finding solutions. This may sound like a semantic difference, particularly considering that many universities and research organizations have been touting their interdisciplinary efforts for some time. But our objective is to break down barriers that still exist, to promote real sharing of tools and expertise, and to incentivize integrative approaches across traditional disciplines. I'll give you a very simple example of how this might work. A specialist in infectious diseases might want to understand how a virus spreads in a population, changing from a local cluster of cases to an international pandemic. A mathematician might be studying a theoretical problem that has strikingly similar properties, but not be thinking about the practical applications of her work. Bringing the two of them together to integrate their knowledge and perspectives could have substantial benefits for public health. Our first recommendation, directed to academia and government, is to develop and foster a massive knowledge network for science and engineering. Tools like Google Scholar and PubMed, and perhaps surprisingly even Wikipedia, already make scientific literature and scientific knowledge more accessible than ever before. But scientific papers are written in the jargon of their disciplines and published in highly specialized journals. We propose the development of an online, visualized knowledge network that can be mined to reveal unexpected patterns and links between knowledge in different fields. Developing a knowledge network that truly achieves what we're after will be a major undertaking, requiring transdisciplinary thinking and approaches that haven't been invented yet. But its importance for stimulating new insights, for accelerating scientific discovery and application can't be overstated. It would be an immensely powerful means of leveraging scientific information, much of which is not readily available to scientists and engineers in other disciplines because they don't read the relevant literature and don't understand the discipline-specific language. A knowledge network would allow scientists to see similarities between very different areas of investigation, enable innovative use of information across fields, stimulate new collaborative efforts, and focus disparate expertise on problems of common interest. Our second recommendation, also directed to academia and government, is to establish educational paradigms for graduate and postdoctoral training that model transdisciplinary approaches. Traditionally, PhD students, medical research fellows, and postdoctoral trainees develop a strong sense of disciplinary identity because departments cover costs for their training and provide a discipline-based academic home. As disciplinary lines blur and scientific careers increasingly benefit from transdisciplinary collaborations, trainees should be encouraged to move across these disciplinary boundaries, and the boundaries themselves should be made more permeable. There are already some initiatives in transdisciplinary education which we applaud. For example, in 1997, the NSF developed an integrative graduate education and research traineeship to meet the challenges of training US PhD scientists, engineers, and educators with interdisciplinary backgrounds to become leaders and creative agents for change. Our third recommendation, directed to academia, government, and industry, is to expand support for shared core research facilities, especially those that serve multiple disciplinary approaches, and provide funding for stable appointments of professional staff to direct them. Increasingly, research is limited less by ideas and more by access to expensive and rapidly advancing technologies that require specialized expertise. Shared core facilities help solve this problem by providing access and support to multiple investigators and multiple projects, making it unnecessary to develop and host these technologies independently and in parallel. For example, DNA sequencing of the entire genomes could be of value to a medical scientist working to understand a genetic disease, to a pharmacologist looking for natural compounds with therapeutic efficacy, or to an environmental biologist seeking new ways to produce biofuels. But it would not be feasible or strategic for each of these investigators to independently purchase a state-of-the-art, high-throughput DNA sequence analyzer. A shared core facility could meet all of their needs at a fraction of the cost with greater on-site technical expertise. Shared core facilities are an excellent use of limited resources, and their potential has only been partially realized. We recommend increasing institutional, governmental, and industry support for shared research facilities and providing funding and job security for professional staff to direct them. To move in this direction, we recommend a comprehensive evaluation of possible models and case studies aimed at identifying best practices. Our fourth recommendation, directed to academia, is to ensure that faculty appointment and promotion policies recognize, support, and reward contributions to collaborative and transdisciplinary research and education. Although universities have begun to recognize the importance of collaboration across disciplines, the interests of individual departments still frequently come into conflict with creating the best possible environment for genuinely transdisciplinary scholarship. To lower the barriers inherent in the traditional academic organizational structures, universities must be encouraged not only to reward departments for recruiting and retaining transdisciplinary scholars, but to develop stable career tracks that cross or exist outside of departments. The committee offers the following three suggestions. First, to develop guidelines to recognize the specific contributions of collaborators to cooperative research efforts and to dynamic research teams assembled to tackle specific problems, and develop advancement models to reward and retain transdisciplinary researchers. Second, give greater weight to public service in promotion evaluations and consider knowledge export activities, including entrepreneurship, to be a component of public service. And third, to set aside a fraction of faculty appointments for scientists and engineers who bridge traditional departments or schools to facilitate migration across boundaries as fields or interests change. Our fifth recommendation, directed to academia and government, is to better enable transdisciplinary research by scrutinizing current administrative policies, revising them to optimize efficiency and effectiveness, aligning incentives properly, and incorporating dynamic evaluation into future policies. The academic research enterprise faces considerable financial uncertainty, and we believe that the current model is economically unsustainable. We need to scrutinize existing administrative policies to ensure that they serve their intended purposes. The committee, again, developed two specific recommendations that focus on areas of concern. We recommend reassessing policies and requirements for regulatory compliance and reporting, the mechanisms used to ensure safety and financial accountability, with the aim of automating, simplifying, or eliminating those that unduly burden investigators, institutions, and funding agencies. A reassessment should outline procedures for evaluating the impact of regulatory requirements and adjusting policies as needed over time. We recommend a fresh look at academic and government policies for funding faculty salaries and capital projects. Some have raised concern that current policies might incentivize universities to seek funds to hire faculty and construct buildings even during stress times when maximizing direct funding of research might be more important. For example, the existing federal contributed effort penalty penalizes institutions for paying faculty salaries for time devoted to funded research. However, if changes are made, it will be important to have ongoing evaluation so that both the extent and the pace of the policy adjustments can be fine-tuned as needed. Thank you for your attention.